Good morning. I'm Brad Kinchlow. I have the honor to be the principal of Park Hill High School. I say with great regularity that I have the best job in Platte County. Mayor James indicates he has the best job in Kansas City. Where Platte County and Kansas City intersect, we may have to arm wrestle on who has the best job there, but I'm sticking with it. When the mayor's office called and asked if we would be interested in hosting this event, I was honored for our building and excited for our students. And then when given the opportunity to have the students ask the questions that they wanted to have answers for the mayor, I was impressed. Because the questions aren't just for us here today, but they're going out to the rest of the building as we're being streamed and the rest of Kansas City as students all across the city are watching. So I asked the seniors to submit to me a question that they thought they'd like to ask the mayor themselves. And from those, I chose five that I thought would be of interest to Park Hill students, the Park Hill community, and the entire Kansas City area. So with that, Nick Haines is going to host a town hall meeting with five seniors in whom I take great pride.
Thank you, Dr. Kinchlow. In the words of Monty Python, and now for something completely different. I should say this first of all, though, ladies and gentlemen. The last time a man tried to share the stage with Mayor Sly James at a State of the City address, he was wrestled to the ground. So I do feel blessed to be still sitting on this bar stool this morning. Ladies and gentlemen, Mayor Sly James back with us. Mayor James, good to see you.
Thank you, Nick.
An apology, first of all, from our students who had to rush from class to be here. They didn't have a chance to dress up for this occasion. This is how they dress at school these days, Mayor James.
That's a good thing. Especially the bow ties.
Yeah. This, if you want to be a future mayor, is how you have to dress, apparently. Yeah. Five seniors who came up with their questions themselves. I did ask beforehand, did the principal ask you beforehand what your question was going to be or press you on your question?
No, not at all.
How about the superintendent?
No.
Because he's sitting there in the front row. No? Okay. Five questions for you, Mr. Mayor, starting with Blake Knave, again, who is a senior right here at Park Hill High School, which is in Kansas City, Missouri, still within the boundaries of the city.
Absolutely.
Blake.
Hi, Blake.
My question to you is, how does the Kansas City earning tax benefit the
program? It benefits it in a ton of different ways. Start with the basics. We have what's known as a general fund. That's the money that we actually get to spend. It's about $497 million. Of that $497 million, $201 million comes from the earnings tax. The budget for the police department, for example, is about $200 million. Budget for the fire is less than that, about the $170 million range. So without those funds, we wouldn't be able to probably provide anything close to the current level of police support and fire support. But I also brought a list of some projects that are going on and have gone on up here in the Northland that have been directly benefited by the fact that we have the earnings tax. A lot of these are basic infrastructure, but I'll tell you, the fact that their infrastructure is something that is very crucial to the Northland. $2 million to improve Northwest 72nd Street in front of Plaza Middle School, $9 million extending Northwest 72nd Street, $1 million to give residents access to Happy Rock Park in Gladstone, $20 million for the Flintlock flyover, $46 million for construction of new sewers for Twin Forks Creek, those types of things. We make a huge investment in all areas of the city and the Northland. The place where we're investing the most, I think, is in the infrastructure that's been lagging behind and where very much needed.
Okay, Blake, did the mayor answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, Eric Krieger, also a senior right here at Park Hill. What's your question for the mayor?
I want to know how you plan to ensure that Republican Party leaders choose Kansas City over Denver, Las Vegas, and Phoenix for the 2016 National Convention.
Wow. Well, I tell you what, we're going to continue to do exactly what I think that we've been trying to do. We have met with the Republican leadership on a number of occasions to try to impress upon them that if they want to come to a place that's got the friendliest people in the country, where they can do everything that they want, where they can go and visit all of the arts, eat at fantastic restaurants, visit fantastic museums, have a great time on the Plaza, Zona Rosa, all over the city, go to the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum, and all the while know that they're being treated specially in a city, then Kansas City is it, baby. I mean, there's not a whole lot of other places you're gonna go where you're gonna get the type of hands-on treatment we've got here. We've already shown that we can handle it. We did the All-Star Game. Everybody loved the All-Star Game. They left here saying, oh my gosh, I had no idea about Kansas City. They do now. They love the MLS All-Star Game, same situation. This past weekend when we had the Big 12 tournament downtown, also had the Comic-Con tournament, or a group of people there. They were kind of interesting. They were. They weren't wearing jerseys, but they were wearing some stuff, man. And also, we had the NAIA tournament. We had about 45,000 people downtown for that weekend. We can handle the crowds, and we know how to put on a great party. So we're just going to keep hammering that, make sure that they know that it's also economical from them. We're right in the middle of the country. Doesn't take any longer than about 3.5 hours to fly here from any place in the country. Can drive here in a lot of instances in under 8 hours. Where else would you want to go?
Eric, you are the bosses here. This is the public servant. Did he answer your question, Eric?
Yes, he did. Thank you.
Okay. My pleasure. Rachel Winders, your question for the mayor.
Hello.
Hi, Rachel.
Research done at the Women's Foundation of Greater Kansas City proves men's median earnings are 1.4 times greater than women's. So my question to you today is, what can we do in the metropolitan area to bring that ratio closer together?
Well, you know, and it's sad that we're still talking about this, right? I mean, it's all the time. But what we are going to do is exactly why we created and started the WE program, Women's Empowerment. We wanted to get a handle on things inside of City Hall and inside of city government, because it's real hard for us to go out and talk to other people, other companies about what they should do until we know that we're already walking our own walk before we go out and start talking that talk. So we've got some good partners in UMKC Women's Foundation, the Central Exchange, Greater Kansas City Women's Group, to help us look at those types of things. And what we found is that the salaries aren't really a big issue necessarily within city government. It's the positioning. So we've got a lot more men in higher positions than women. That needs to be looked at. Salary differences can be made up, won't they, Troy? Anything like that, that's not a problem. That's going to be taken care of to the extent it exists. Our problem isn't so much the disparity of pay, it's more the disparity of position. That has to change. We have to take the glass ceiling off. We have to get rid of all that. We have to understand that women in any organization make that organization better. They're the ones that are focused on solutions. They're less inclined to get all macho men and all that other nonsense. They want to get to somewhere and they get there fast. Can't really do this job without women. So we want women in our government and we want women in our employ. And in order to do that, we treat them with the same level and dignity of respect as anybody else.
Rachel, satisfied with the answer?
Yes, thank you very much.
Okay, Joey Cation at the back there, your question for the mayor.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, my question is about the possible change in the Stand Your Ground law in Kansas City, which would make it so homeowners would have to retreat into their homes before they could shoot their attackers. How do you feel this will affect our murder rates, which are still some of the highest in the country?
Well, I'm not sure that it's going to affect the murder rate. I am more concerned about the change in common sense that this may imply to some extent. I've always been, I'm a practicing attorney, have been for 30 years, I've always been the person who's believed in self-defense. You have an absolute right to defend yourself, your family, property from imminent, grievous bodily harm or severe damage. Now, I also recognize, like every case that I ever had, there are no two instances that are exactly the like. Common sense, it has to enter in somewhere, and the facts of a particular circumstance have to control what is deemed as reasonable or not. There are some things that you listen to. Any common sense person can listen to a story that somebody tells them and says, you know what, man, I was at the house the other night, and I was just back in the back playing Nintendo or whatever the heck it is we play these days, and somebody broke into the house, and they kept charging and charging. I had to fire on them and take them out because they wouldn't stop. They were threatening us. They broke down the door. You can kind of go along with that, right? But then if it changes substantially, you start saying, well, wait a minute, that doesn't make much sense. Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? That's one of the problems I have with the whole change in the law and the law itself, basically, because it set up a straw man. You know what is reasonable. If somebody breaks into your house, refuses to leave, and is threatening you, then yes, you have every right to defend yourself. But if you're standing out on the curb, and by going into your house, you could avoid getting shot or shooting somebody, maybe that's a good idea, maybe not. It depends on the circumstances. The problem is whether or not the law is applied equally to everybody that comes before it, how much racism gets brought into the law because of who the victim may be and who the perpetrator may be seen to be, and whether or not the penalties are being exercised in a reasonable and consistent manner. So that's where I have a problem with it. But I've always believed in self-defense. Everybody's got a right to it. And common sense and the circumstances should dictate whether or not you kill somebody. One last thing. This whole idea about it somehow seems surgical, and because none of us have had to experience it in most of our lives, it's hard to imagine. But there is a toll that is taken on both the person who is killed and the person who does the killing. I don't care whether it was justified or not, you don't kill somebody and just say, oh, well, it has an impact. It affects the people that you love, it affects your family, it affects the family elsewhere. So from my perspective, I'm going to always do everything I possibly can to avoid either being killed or killing somebody. I will do what I have to, but I'm going to make sure that that's what I have to do, not something that I just think I can do.
Okay. Are you satisfied, Joey?
Yes, I am. Thank you very much.
Okay. We're going to go to Andrew Jimenez, right at the front here.
All right. Before I start, I just have to say I was at Comic-Con. It was great. Loved it. Flying Saucer is the best restaurant out there.
All right. All right. I'm with you. I don't know if that had a... I don't know, were you following a theme there with the flying saucer?
No, it just kind of tied in with everything.
Okay, I got
but
you.
My question is basically, the disturbances that happened last summer at West Point or Westport and the Plaza areas caused by young people, what are your plans to fix that? Also, do you think that will happen in Zona Rosa this year?
I should say, for people, we are right next to Zona Rosa right here at Park Hill High School.
I think the circumstances are a little bit more, are a little bit different in Zona Rosa versus the Plaza, for example. Different types of stores, different kinds of clientele, different grounds, different rules for the grounds, very well posted. A very active on-site security group that runs around and says, what are you doing here? See you later, get gone. If you're not there buying something, then you're probably gonna move on. Plus the stores close earlier, so then you're not old enough to get in the bars, so you're not gonna hang out. All right, you're gonna go someplace where you can hang out. And all of you, do y'all hang out somewhere?
Yeah.
All get together somewhere? Where you get together? A movie?
House.
House?
No? House.
All right, all right. But you all hang out. That's a natural thing, we've all done it. Even some of the old people here used to hang out. We just hung out in a different place. Doing different things. But the how are we going to handle that? We're going to handle it by trying to do the things that we've been talking about. Number one, we can't simply throw kids out of places. We have to give them a place to go. And that's why we got started with our summer programming with Club KC, with the Night Kicks, Night Hoops, Night Nets, and started to expand those programs. And let me tell you what happens during the summer months as a direct result of those programs that we have. In the first year that we started, right after the shooting incident on the Plaza, in that first year, juvenile crime both victims and perpetrators went down 16%, okay, during those times. In the second year, it went down 18%. That tells me something. Occupied minds and kids and bodies will do something more productive than get into trouble. If they're not occupied, then you're gonna find a bunch that get into trouble. So give them something to do. The next thing that we're trying to do is we really, really, really need jobs. The city hires a lot of kids during the summertime. We had, I think we hired about 100 last year, give or take, but we had 350 show up for the interviews. What happens to the 250 we couldn't hire? What are they doing? It used to be when I was growing up, you had a summer job. If you didn't have a summer job, you don't come home. I mean, that's just the way it was. Because if you went home and mom was there, then you wish you had had a summer job so you wouldn't have to be there, okay? But I laid sod in doing those types of things so that when I was so tired at the end of the day from picking up 50-pound rolls of sod for 8 or 10 hours out in the sun, I didn't have any energy to go anywhere. Thus, my bank account got to be a lot heftier, saved a lot of money. We need summer jobs, all right? But we need parents to start parenting. We need churches to start churching. We need nonprofits to start nonprofiting. We need
I feel like this is a whole different topic you're getting into.
No, no. If we're going to deal with youth and the issues that we have with youth, we have to do that as a community. We have, the city cannot take care of every child in this city.
Andrew, were you satisfied with the answer? Were you expecting something more?
More than definitely. He explained it a lot better than what he did, than what I expected from him.
Very good. Well,
I'm not sure what that meant.
Well, Mayor James, I mean, you could have been at City Hall delivering a State of the City address.
Yeah, could have been.
You know, not coming to Park Hill High School at all.
Right.
And not engaging with students at all. Why did you do this, period?
To be real honest with you, you'll be surprised where you get really good ideas. And there's this whole segment of people that the younger they are, the fewer times people ask them for their ideas. It seems like you have to reach some magical numerical birthdays before your opinions start to matter, and usually that might be in the workplace. There's a lot of good things going on in the minds of students in this city. When we went to students and said, what can we do to provide you with a place to eat, play and have a good time without any problems, they told us, we did it, it's working. Why not ask for some more help on some other things? The other thing too is that I don't care how you try to escape it. Some of you are going to live in this city for the rest of your lives. So you can either take an opportunity to get to know it and engage so that you have some control over the shape, or you can be a person who does nothing more than complain about those things as you get older. I encourage you to be the former, not the latter.
And these were heavy questions. These weren't questions like boxes or briefs, PlayStation or Xbox 360, Mayor James.
Yeah, well, actually, I don't have either of those and boxers.
Okay, all right.
Yes.
Mayor James, students, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, give them a hand.
Thank you.